For this afternoon's program, we will give each of the three speakers approximately 20 minutes to share their thoughts and reflections. Afterwards, we will then have approximately 45 minutes per hour for open forum where we'll take questions from the floor. We tried to design the forum in such a way where there would be plenty of time for conversation, which is really key. So we'll begin the first of our speakers this afternoon. Edmundo Garcia is a tireless champion of peace, human rights, and social justice worldwide. He did his postgraduate studies in political and social sciences in Mexico, and later became a senior researcher for the Latin American Department, International Secretariat of Amnesty International in 1978 to 1980. For two decades, he has served as a peace envoy and senior advisor in the peace-building organization, International Alert. He has accompanied peace advocates and engaged with multi-sectoral stakeholders in diverse regions of conflict in Asia, Africa, Latin America, and Europe. He was also a member of the original Constitutional Convention. So without further ado, we invite Mr. Ed Garcia.
Fellow citizens, fellow Ateneans, and my dear brother from De La Salle University, brother. The Loyola Heights campus of the Ateneo brings back wonderful memories of conversations with friends, of celebrations, and most of all, preparations. In this campus, I remember preparing for exams, preparing for intramural games, preparing for dates, and with our modest means, preparing to do battle with oppressive rule and injustice inflicted on the most vulnerable. Today, on the eve of the 31st anniversary of the people's approval of the 1987 Constitution, which falls on the 2nd of February, I wish to share a simple message that is direct and to the point. No to a new Constitution, not now. And no to federalism, not at this time. My hope, together to take a stand, and together to take action. Having said that, allow me to discuss possible charter change in 2018. Actually, the title of my short piece is The Courage to Confront Charter Change, which is similar now to a bullet train. It might be helpful for our purposes to focus our thoughts on just three key issues: context, process, and preparation. Since we are given not more than 20 minutes, allow me to begin. Without understanding the context, the draft text will just be pretext. What then are the main challenges and priorities in our country? I believe that the priority issue we confront is this: the poverty of our people and the inequality in our midst. Poverty. We need to focus on the critical challenges in the country. Instead of embarking on charter change at this time that will consume energy and resources, why not further focus on addressing the massive poverty in the country while reducing the level of inequality that exists today? This year, I am a member of High School 58. We celebrate our Diamond Jubilee. Imagine, 60 years after our high school graduation, that's a long time. One of my classmates, Mahar Malakas, of the Social Welfare Stations, sent me the SWS findings, which they will present tomorrow at AIM. Look at these figures. The SW self-rated poverty for 2017, 46% of our people rate themselves as poor, almost one out of every two, with 52% in Mindanao. It was 44% for some 10 million families. We are not improving. The highest poverty incidence is among farmers and fishermen, not to mention indigenous peoples, people with disabilities, and victims of natural disasters, according to the Philippine Statistics Authority. Food poor families. The SWS data says that 33% of our families consider themselves lacking in food for 2017. That's one out of every three. Hunger. 15.9 or 3.6 million families, or one out of every six Filipinos, experienced involuntary hunger at least once in the past 3 months. That's a 4.1 increase from the third quarter. The poorer half of the poor lack half of what they need to survive. In other words, this is serious. This is urgent. Can you imagine the amount of resources and effort and energy that should be directed at this most important of all challenges in our country? Inequality. The Gini coefficient. In the scale of 1 to 10, from most to least unequal, where 10 represents the worst inequality, the Philippines has 0.44 in that scale for 2015. Listen to this. With slight variations from 1988 to 2015, for nearly two decades, there has been no significant change in our Gini index, hovering around 0.44. In other words, we have stood still, as if we were running the treadmill. So, what focus must we put as a people? You know, I brought with me a copy of one of the few originals of the Philippine Constitution. And the very heart of this Constitution is Article 13, the Article on Social Justice and Human Rights. Our challenge is one of substance and not form. Address the most urgent problems of our people, poverty and inequality. If we need to wage war, then it must be a war on poverty and inequality. The framers of the 1987 Constitution put out a statement recently, and we said, the 1987 Constitution is not the problem. It is part of the solution. We do not need a new constitution now. What we need is to identify our priorities and seek to make poverty history and radically reduce inequality. Secondly, process. Why is trust in the process critical? For nearly three decades, I have worked on helping to make and build peace in diverse regions of conflict in Africa, in Asia, and Latin America. I have seen peace agreements forged and broken. And what is a key lesson that I have drawn from these experiences? Trust, and the importance of trust in the process. If you trust the process, then you will trust the outcome. So let me go over a few points which I think you may wish to consider. Take Article 17, Section 1 of the Constitution, which actually speaks about how do you amend or revise the Constitution. And it says, as the first section, the Congress, upon a vote of 3/4 of all its members. And then in Article 6, Section 1, which is on the legislative department, it defines Congress. What is Congress? The House of Representatives and the Senate. Those of you who watched the Senate hearings, and Dean Ron was actually one of those resource persons there. It was made very clear that if we have a bicameral system, then we need both houses, the Senate and the House of Representatives, to vote separately. But I understand that there's been a compromise between the Speaker and the Senate President, and they said, let's go, let's make amendments to the Constitution, and we'll speak about this process later on. You know, on Sunday, I think the 4th of February, your favorite Lady Eagles will play their first volleyball game at MOA at 4 p.m. And I think many of you will be there. Can you imagine? Okay, game time. Let's play. Okay, they play. Wait a minute. What are the rules of the game? Is this 5 sets or 7 sets? Is it five people playing or is it 9 people playing? In other words, what are the rules of the game? Is it, no, just play. Make amendments. You know, I just received an email from a friend of mine who is one of the leaders of the Filipinos living here abroad. Says, please give me amendments. We will send it to the consultative body. But the point is, before we even do that, there is a prior question. Do we even need a new constitution? The principal argument for a CONAS, which actually is a very apt name, is that it is cheaper. It will provide savings in the billions. As former Chief Justice Renato Puno said during the hearings, this is a cheap argument. For there can be no better investment in our future than in properly drafting the fundamental law of the land. Or as our beloved Dean Ron put it during that same evening, the only thing more costly than a constitutional convention is a governance disaster. And I can assure you, fellow citizens, fellow Ateneans, and my brother from the side, I can assure you, we are in for a disaster. Cost-benefit analysis of the shift to federalism. What is the cost of possible estimates of the shift to federalism? To have confidence in the undertaking, there must be both proper planning and transparency in the process. Before we embark on a major overhaul towards federalism, first consider the options, the roadmaps, the alternatives, and the comparative and comprehensive costs of the entire enterprise. In other words, each proposal must be accompanied by a corresponding cost-benefit estimate in the short, medium, and long term so that we can know what we are getting into. Diba? Ginagawa natin yun. If you want to go into a business with your friend, do a business plan. Magkano ba siya? Kaya ba natin ito? Eh dito, napakalagang ginagawa natin. Pero lahat tayo in the dark. There is no transparency in the process. And then another point, dealing with the process, the conflict of interest. Who will benefit in drafting a new constitution? We the people or the members of the CONASES who will draft the charter? In other words, a consultative body, 19 of whom have been named, with one token woman, has been tasked to do a preliminary draft which I understand will be submitted to a constituent assembly. It is Congress, therefore, which at the last analysis will decide, unless I prove wrong. I repeat, if you trust the process, you will trust the outcome. But how can you trust the process if you cannot trust the people behind the process? How do we make sure they do not serve their own interests when they craft the new charter? Let me go to my last point, preparation. How can we better prepare? What are the preconditions for charter change in the scenic going on for a level playing field? In other words, this is a question I would like to pose before Speaker Alvarez. Why put the cart before the horse? Ask any champion team. Ask the Blue Eagles, ask Tab and 30, ask anyone of the team, what is the secret of their success? I can assure you, it is not magic. More than anything else, it is preparation. The same goes for the task of amending or revising the Constitution. First prepare, and then ensure that certain preconditions are put in place that would allow for a viable federalism to work. I would suggest that we focus on the following realities on the ground: political dynasties, private armed groups, political parties, electoral reforms, public information, and the unholy alliance between Imperial Manila and the regional and local dynasties. That, I submit, are the areas we need to prepare for. Actually, we're very fortunate because in the campus we have the Ateneo School of Government, which has done a lot of work on political dynasties. And you have the man behind the research right here. According to their study, 4 out of every 5 of our representatives belong to political families or dynasties. Among our local leaders, 4 out of every 5 of our governors belong to political families. And 69% of our mayors belong to the political dynasties. Some 94% of our provinces have political dynasties, which number in the 170. No wonder people call us the world capital of political dynasties. Of course, there is a silver lining. There is some good news. The Republic Act 10742, the Sangguniang Kabataan Reform Act, actually contains a landmark provision that bars relatives of elected officials up to the second degree of consanguinity or affinity to any elected incumbent from pursuing sangguniang kabataan posts. And the rationale for that is because the lack of a real political competition leads to flawed policies at the local level. Private armed groups, again, the study is found at the School of Government. In 3 regions alone, according to that study, that is Baksamono, Northern Luzon, and Central Visayas, there are 63 private armed groups. Can we not eliminate these legal groups first before we contemplate a major shift of power that in the end will be more difficult to reverse? Political parties. Can we enforce the criteria on the formation of political political parties, in other words, requiring them to have a program of government. Can we prohibit turncoatism and make it more difficult to continue with the phenomenon of the balikbings that virtually made political party affiliation meaningless? Could you believe we even want to shift a parliamentary form of government which is founded on strong political parties? And now, we actually have one supermajority, one political party that makes decisions. Electoral reform. Can we consider radical changes in the way we elect our regional or local leaders instead of the first-past-the-post winner-take-all spoil system of electing our representatives? Can we explore the viability of proportional representation? Public education. 73% of our people are unfamiliar with the 1987 Constitution after 30 years. How much time do we need in the formation of our people? Consulting them first regarding their inputs into the draft and then helping them understand a new draft prior to a referendum. Because you hear our congressional leaders say, don't worry, the people will decide. But then, you decide intelligently. And how do you do that? By public information, the formation of conscience and so on.
This is the local government rule.
The local government code of 1991. Before undertaking the task of incorporating federalism into a new constitution, why not revisit the 1991 local government code first? Do you know, in section 521, there is a mandate that once every 5 years, Congress must review. You know, I was recently in the meetings with 14 senators. And then I had a conversation with the Deputy Speaker of the House of Representatives. I asked them, how often and with what result has those mandatory reviews resulted in? How many would like to take a guess? How many times have we reviewed this? And the law says once every 5 years. Can you count the number of years? How many times have we reviewed? Does anybody want to hazard a guess? In 27 years, how often have we... Yes, please. Yeah, exactly. Zero. If you are really serious about strengthening local government powers, why not improve? Why not strengthen? Why have you not done anything yet? So, if you can't do this, how much more doing a constitution? Then finally, the collusion between Imperial Manila and the dynastic periphery. If federalism is the answer, then let me rephrase the question. What truly ails our country? What has caused our inability to end the poverty of our people and the inequality in our society? Studies have shown that in the end, there is a collusion between Imperial Manila and the dynastic periphery who thrive on the political economy of government capture. That's a result of your studies. In other words, this is proven. You know. The proponents of federalism through charter change argue that the main development is Imperial Manila. Ateneo research has shown that it is this and more. It is the collusion between the center and the dynastic periphery that creates the concentration of political power combined with economic monopolies found in the regions. We therefore need to prepare. If we do not, we will merely allow our fiefdoms to mushroom throughout the land. Without serious effort to dismantle the private armies, dislodge the political dynasties, address impunity and crime and corruption, inclusive socio-economic development, and people's empowerment cannot prosper in the periphery. These obstacles must be seen as preconditions, without which the shift to federalism will simply be a case of jumping from the frying pan into the fire. Allow me to conclude. Fellow citizens, fellow Ateneans, and my brother from De La Salle University, the most important actor in a democracy is the citizen. And we are citizens all. What we need at this time is Ignatius of Loyola's gift of discernment and the moral courage of a soldier turned saint. Moral courage is brave behavior in the face of risks and threats, despite all the costs. It means the ability to do the right thing in the right way in the face of one's fears. It demands that we remain firm in staying the course, to exhibit fortitude, and to adhere one's convictions and principles. There are times when we know that the odds are stacked heavily against us. Nevertheless, we go ahead and take a stand and take action because it is what our convictions and conscience tell us. As one of the leaders in the emancipation of colored people during the American Civil War put it, the probability that we may fail in the struggle ought not to deter us from the support of a cause we believe to be just. In times like ours, and in a world so deeply divided and burdened, beset by the politics of hate and fear, by political discourse turned uncivil and divisive, by the transgressions against human dignity, or the intolerance against people who are different, or the inability to live with diversity, when hope is such in short supply, it is important to dig deep into our reservoir of moral courage. Change in our country and in the world around us will begin only if there are changes in our mindset and in the way we confront the challenges that beset us. Dealing with our fears with uncommon courage, bringing about hope in uncertain times. You know, nearly 4 decades ago, I remember I led the Amnesty International mission to Colombia. We were in Popayan. We were in a jail in Popayan. And there were indigenous peoples who were imprisoned. In fact, they had bullet wounds that were flesh in their flesh. And I recall the encounter so clearly, as if it was yesterday, because I asked the leader of the Consejo Regional Indígena del Cauca, I asked him, ¿Aún tienes sentido su lucha? Is there still meaning in your struggle? And you know his answer, his response to me was, Aún amanece en la noche más oscura. Dawn comes even after darkest night. In the midst of seeming despair, he brought home to me the meaning of hope in the starkest manner. If only one believes in a cause bigger than oneself and musters the courage to remain true to one's northern star, then hope lives. It is kept alive. Hope is not some kind of optimism, an expectation or a wish that things will become better or that things will improve. It is a belief in oneself and in others, a belief founded on our sense of purpose, pursuing meaning in what we do, and who we are. It is hope that allows us to pursue the marathon journey and to take the first step and the next after that. Hope is not the expectation of a better day to come. It is a belief that a new day is possible because we strive to make it happen. Though it may not always be in the same shape and form that we initially envisioned. Hope, moreover, requires the power of love. So that we put our hands to the plow with all our heart and not turn back. Because oftentimes the journey is not only about ourselves, but those whose lives we have touched, or those whose lives have touched ours. Fellow citizens, fellow Ateneans, and my brother from Mendoza, together let us say no to a new constitution, not now. No to federalism at this time, not at this time. And yes, to pledge ourselves to work towards a new day for the country we love. Mabuhay tayo lahat. Salamat.